I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than house or land.
Rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dead sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this whole world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause.
I'd rather be faithful
to his dear cause.
I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. Rather be faithful to his holy name than to be
the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway.
I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. This world affords today.
Thank you so much, Daryl and Susan. Thank you, worship team. So a couple things before we get into the sermon. I want to mention our worship team, Blythe and the wonderful worship team that we have is putting together a great Easter Sunday for you. So you know, there's going to be a lot of music. I'm shortening the message significantly. So that there's going to be time for us. There's going to be congregational singing. There's going to be some extra specials. I think there's going to be some duets. I heard there's going to be some duets. So if you don't want to miss it, that's all I'm just going to tell you, all right? I don't want to give it all away. You don't want to miss it. You're going to want to be here for that on Easter Sunday. So it's going to be fantastic. And then something I wanted to mention before I got into the message. Actually, you know what? Let me save that for later. I'm going to keep you all in suspense. Now you have to wonder about that. That's going to happen in a little bit. Turn your Bibles, if you would, to Exodus chapter 3. So turn or click if you have a physical copy of the Word of God. Turn, click if you have a digital copy of the Word of God. So Exodus chapter 3. So last week we first got introduced to Moses. And we see that the people of Israel are in slavery in the land of Egypt, and their lives are not going well. As a matter of fact, we talked about how God has finally now fulfilled the promise to make them many people, right? They are many people, but it isn't looking too good because their lives are terrible. They're miserable. And we get introduced to Moses in that, and we kind of leave it on at the end of chapter 2. We left it on sort of a cliffhanger of how is this going to get fixed? How is this going to change? What is God going to do with this? So we're going to see Moses in action. God calls and Moses answers, sort of. He's a little hesitant. We'll talk about that. And then he moves him into position to be the one to free the people of Israel. And we won't get a chance to go through all that. We're going to look at his calling. We're going to specifically look at God calling Moses. And then we're going to look at the first five plagues. And now the reason for this is, as we journey through this next Sunday, Palm Sunday, we're going to be able to look at the next four. We're going to do everything but the last plague, so that we're going to save that when we talk about the Passover. There's going to be a section that we're going to get into right on Easter Sunday. And there's going to be a shorter message about how the Passover, what it meant, and how it's connected to the reason that we celebrate Resurrection Sunday. The whole reason that we celebrate Resurrection Sunday, Christ rising from the dead, Christ's finished work of redemption in our lives, is deeply connected to what he teaches the Israelites in and through the Passover. So we're gonna have this great progression that's gonna lead up to that. So you're not gonna wanna miss a single Sunday, because then you won't have the whole progression. You won't see how it all connects. And the one of the many beautiful, awesome, amazing things about God's word is that from Genesis to Revelation, it connects. It's the beautiful, amazing love story of God to us, to human beings. It's God saying to us, I want to know you. I want to be near you. I want you to know me. That's God's word. And so we're going to get a chance to see that together. You're not going to want to miss it. So this morning, today, let's look first at Moses' calling through the burning bush. Now, how about this for a way that God calls you and tells you that he wants you to do something for him? Amazing. Oh, Exodus 3, verses 1 through 9. So remember, Moses has run from Egypt, right? And he's living in Midian. He met this guy and his daughters, he married one of his daughters, and so he just kind of become a part of their family group. So he's busy, he's left everything behind, he's busy doing that. That's where we pick up the scene with Moses. Now Moses was pasturing the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed. So Moses said, I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. Now listen to this. He said also, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters, for I am aware of their sufferings. So I have come down to them. I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians, and to bring them up from that land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittite and the Amorite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. Now behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians are oppressing them. So God is declaring to Moses, I'm the same God. I'm the same God that came to Abraham, that came to Isaac, and that came to Jacob. I'm the same God that guided Joseph in his time of slavery here in Egypt and rose him up to the position that he was in to rescue not only that nation, but several nations of the earth. God is saying, Moses, I'm that same God. talking to you right now. And I have heard what my people, I'm not blind to what they're going through. I'm going to rescue them. He says, look again at verse 8. I've come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians and bring them up to a good and spacious land. He's getting ready to fulfill another part of the promise that he made to Abraham so many years ago. In no uncertain terms, God is declaring who he is and that he's the keeper of his promises. So he comes to Moses, he calls Moses. This conversation continues. And I want to kind of, we're going to skip around a little bit and touch on parts of it. We're going to look at verse 10, then we're going to look at chapter 4, verse 1, and so forth. Because I want to highlight a couple of things out of you. This conversation between Moses and God kind of goes back and forth. And despite all this reassurance, Moses continues to be hesitant. I mean, think about a call of God in your life that comes in an audible way from a burning bush that doesn't get burned all the way up. I feel like, I don't know, I would be afraid to say no or to be resistant at all, but somehow Moses isn't. Yeah, like you would be a little bit afraid to be like, well, God, I don't know. I don't think I'm your guy. Because that's what he does, and we're going to look at that. So let's look at it. So he tells him this, the mission of Moses, verse 10. Therefore, come now. So this is God speaking to him. I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. Then Moses says this, but Moses said, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? It kind of goes on from there. Let's look at chapter 4, verse 1. Because God keeps saying, I'm going to do this through you. You're going to be my man for this. And Moses keeps saying in some different way, how can I? Or maybe I'm not. Or are you sure? Maybe you meant to call somebody else out of a burning bush. So 4 verse 1, we see it again. So God encouraged him, you're going to be my guy, you're going to do it. Chapter 4 verse 1, then Moses said, what if they will not believe me or listen to what I say? For they may say, the Lord has not appeared to you. The Lord just said to them, what is in your hands? And he said, a staff. Then he said, throw it on the ground. So he threw it on the ground, it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it. But the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand and grasp it by its tail. So he stretched out his hand and caught it, and it became a staff in his hand. It goes on from there. God even gives him signs to tell him, look, you're my guy. So God, he's very patient with him in these moments where it keeps going back and forth. Then verse 10 of chapter 4. God's still reassuring him that he's his guy. Verse 10, then Moses said to the Lord, please, Lord, I have never been eloquent. So he comes up with another excuse. Neither recently nor in times past nor since you have spoken to your servant, for I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. The Lord said to him, who has made man's mouth, or who makes him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now then go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you are to say. Even after saying that, look at Moses' response. But he said, please, Lord, now send the message by whomever you will. That's the old-fashioned way of saying, God, please send anyone except for me. Anybody, please, Lord, anybody but me. There's got to be somebody else. We're just going to look at the very next verse. There's lots more to look at, but verse 14, look at this. Then the anger of the Lord burned against Moses, and he said, is there not your brother Aaron the Levite? I know that he speaks fluently, and moreover, behold, he is coming out to meet you. When he sees you, he will be glad in his heart. So after following that, God tells him, okay, look, Aaron's going to help you out. Despite so much reassurance, so much guarantee, directly, audibly from God. Ironically, Moses would keep making excuses to the point of angering God than have to go face Pharaoh. And I think that as we look at this, I think there's a good message for us about doubts and fears. Because again, we see this, and we've seen this so many times already. We've seen that people in God's word were just people. like us. They had doubts and fears. They had questions and concerns. So God said, look, you're going to be my mouthpiece. You're going to be okay. I'm going to go with you. This is what I want you to do. And so even God says to him, like, we're going to have a plan. There's a plan that you're going to follow this plan. That he gives him, it's like the instruction manual. He gives him the instruction manual. He says, here it is. You're going to follow it. You do it. I'll tell you what to do. You just have to do it. You just be my mouthpiece. You just be the guy. If you think back to when we were in the book of Acts at the end of last year, and we talked about the birth of the church, we talked about the Holy Spirit. Jesus is leaving the disciples behind. He says, I'm going to leave you a helper, a paraclete. That's the Greek word, right? Another helper is going to come when I go. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the instruction manual, right? He comes and he lives in those who believe in Jesus, and he empowers the church to follow the instruction manual. And now, the moment you've all been waiting for, this I said I was going to do at the beginning. This is why I waited on this. So this is a thank you card from Harborview Elementary School to our church. And they're thanking us. I'm going to read it for you in just a second. They're thanking us because of the actions of one of our 710 Serve groups. Yes, our 710 Serve group has been partnering with Harborview Elementary, in this case in particular, to provide needed hygiene items. There's a lot of lower income families at Harborview Elementary. And so one of our 710 Serve groups came through to do that for them, and they sent this thank you. Guess what that Serve group was doing? They're following the instruction plan. God already gave it to us. The Holy Spirit is already living inside you to tell you to go out to a lost and dying world. He's telling you the exact same thing that God was telling directly to Moses. Don't be afraid. I'm going to go with you. I'm going to be right there. I'm going to put the words in your mouth. I'm going to teach you what you need to say. Go meet the people. Go see those who don't know me. Go be my mouthpiece. That's what he's saying. So Harborview, this is from the principal. They said this. Dear partners at First Baptist Summerfield, thank you for your most generous gift of hygiene pouches for our growing up fifth graders. We appreciate your willingness to serve in this way. My late father-in-law, Keith, I'm not sure of the last name, was raised in your church. What a blessing. God bless you as you continue to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you, brother. Amen indeed. We've been talking about church revitalization a lot. I've been talking about it from here. I've been talking about it with people one-on-one. I've been talking about it in other formats. We've been talking specifically about doing 710 Serve. Right, we're saying that we're going to revitalize this church. We're going to get serious about the mission of bringing the truth of the gospel to our community, and 710 Serve is the way we're going to do it. Everybody, this, to me, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is just the beginning, and it should be very exciting and encouraging to us that just by getting started, we can make an impact. He's saying the same thing to Moses. Just get started. It's exactly what we said last week. Just say yes. You don't have to know all the answers. God's telling Moses, look, maybe you're not the most qualified. Maybe we don't know what he has. Some theologians think maybe he had a stutter or something like that when he said he was not eloquent and slow of speech. And so maybe God was saying to him, like, okay, you've got this speech impediment of some kind. Doesn't matter. I'm going to take care of it. You don't know everything there is to know. Doesn't matter. I'm going to take care of it. He's saying the exact same thing to us. He's saying it to you right now, today. He's saying, say yes to your neighbor, to your friend, to your relative who doesn't know Jesus. Just start a conversation. You don't have to get them saved. You just have to share. The Holy Spirit does the work. Remember, we talked about that a lot in the book of Acts. He's telling Moses, you don't have to overcome Pharaoh. You just got to be my guy. You got to be God's guy or gal in that moment. And that's it. That's the beautiful thing. He takes care of the rest. Whatever it is God is saying, he's saying he'll go with you. He will enable you to do the ministry that he has that you never thought you could do. Well, despite all this, Moses brings Aaron to him. He gets them together, and they go. We're going to look at chapter 4, verse 27. Let's skip down to verse 27. Look at this. So God speaks to Aaron too. Now the Lord said to Aaron, go to meet Moses in the wilderness. So he went and met him at the mountain of God and kissed him. Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord with which he had sent him and all the signs that he had commanded him to do. Then Moses and Aaron went and assembled all the elders of the sons of Israel. And Aaron spoke all the words which the Lord had spoken to Moses. He then performed the signs in the sight of the people. Now look at the result. Verse 31. So the people believed. And when they had heard that the Lord was concerned about the sons of Israel and that he had seen their affliction, then they bowed low and worshiped. They just needed to go. I personally believe that God could have done this just through Moses. He could have done it that way. Now, again, we don't necessarily have that explanation here, so that's my personal theology on how I think this could have worked out. That's not in Scripture. That's just my view on it. But Moses was so afraid to do it himself that God added Aaron to meet Moses where he was at. So in this way, Aaron is with him and he does become Moses' mouthpiece. But the result, despite Moses' shortcomings, despite his fears and failures, God's plan still happens. The people believe. Verse 31, the people believed when they saw, when they heard. So the result is still good. And I think, again, we're going to have to stop and pause again. There's more good application for us in this moment with them. It's sometimes when you're trying to find your footing in going and telling and whatever it is that God's called you to, whatever way that he's called you to minister, to follow him, sometimes you need to find your Aaron to help get you started on the path. And it's very true because he's given us all different gifts. That's why the New Testament talks so much about the church being the body and functioning like a body. Someone's a better hand, another person's a better foot, somebody else is a better ear, someone else is a better eye. These are all just metaphorically speaking. We all have different gifts that the Holy Spirit has given us. And sometimes you just need to find your Aaron to help get you started down the path. Again, just say yes and trust God with the details, but also maybe there's a close friend who can go with you. Maybe there's a good encourager you know who can go with you to get you started on what it is you feel the Holy Spirit prompting you to do. Maybe you just need to find your Aaron. So Moses and Aaron, they go together. So they go to the people and then they go to Pharaoh. Right? And God says through them to Pharaoh, it's time. My people are leaving your country. We're not doing this anymore. It's over. So, as you can imagine, this gets Pharaoh pretty worked up. He doesn't know yet the power of the God he's dealing with. He does not understand the power of Almighty God, the creator of heaven and earth. Pharaoh hasn't faced that before. He's about to. He doesn't know it. And he says, no, I'm not doing that. And indeed, actually, he makes things really hard for Moses and Aaron at first. Because when they first go and tell him God said this, he's like, oh yeah? Guess what? Now I'm going to make things even worse. This is a classic military move right here. When you had one guy in your platoon that was the screw up, and there was always that one guy. There was. The platoon sergeant knows the best way to fix that guy is for everyone else to fix that guy. So what does he do? He makes life miserable for everyone else until you all eventually have the common enemy of the guy who's the screw up. Yes, exactly. This guy is ruining our lives. So Pharaoh does the same trick. He's like an evil platoon sergeant. Except for he's not doing it to try to make them a team. He's doing it to make them public enemy. He's like, I'm going to take the straw away. He's been providing straw for the Israelites to make bricks. That's one of their main slave labor activities, make bricks. And they have these quotas they have to fill. And so Pharaoh says, guess what? No more straw, get your own straw, but you still got to meet the same quota. And so the people of Israel are just like, basically to Moses and Aaron, they're like, What did you do? Moses and Aaron become like that screw-up guy in the platoon. The rest of the people of Israel are like the rest of the platoon. They're like, you're killing us here. What are you doing? I don't think this is what God had in mind. This is wrecking everything. Well, God's about to show that he has power, right? So this kind of goes back and forth, and so then we get into the plague. So you're actually going to have to turn over to Exodus 7. Turn over to Exodus 7, because there's more of this interplay back and forth, and Pharaoh is continuing to harden his heart. There's some deep theology here that hopefully we have a chance to talk about during our question-answer time that we'll do on April 7th, because there's some deep things here about talking about God says he's going to harden Pharaoh's heart. He's going to show his signs and wonders through him. We'll talk about that some. But this process keeps going, and so then God now says, okay, I'm going to show my power. And so he starts bringing these plagues. Right, and the first one is the blood. We're going to look at chapter 7, starting in verse 14. Then the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh's heart is stubborn. He refuses to let the people go. Go to Pharaoh in the morning as he is going out to the water and station yourself to meet him on the bank of the Nile. And you shall take in your hand the staff that was turned into a serpent. You shall say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, sent me to you, saying, let my people go, that they may serve me in the wilderness. But behold, you have not listened until now. Thus says the Lord, by this you shall know that I am the Lord. Behold, I will strike the water that is in the Nile with the staff that is in my hand, and it will be turned to blood. The fish that are in the Nile will die. The Nile will become foul, and the Egyptians will find difficulty in drinking water from the Nile. Then the Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, take your staff and stretch out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over their rivers, over their streams, and over their pools, and over their reservoirs of water, that they may become blood. And there will be blood throughout all the land of Egypt. Listen to this, not just in the Nile, both in vessels of wood and in vessels of stone. God is showing that he has power over all the water in Egypt. Not just the water in the Nile, right? That God has power, that it's not the gods that the Egyptians worship. It's not these false gods that they serve, but that it's the God, it's God Almighty. He's showing, and he's told Moses before this, and then after this, he continues to tell them that he's going to show his power through signs and wonders. Now, remember, in the book of Acts, we talked about signs of wonders several times. On several occasions, we got to see through the apostles, through Paul, all these miracles that the Holy Spirit was doing. It was miracles of healing, of speaking in other languages miraculously, that God was saying, that the Holy Spirit was saying, I'm proving that my church is here through these signs and wonders. I'm proving that this is something of me, so that the Jews would see it, they would understand it, and then they would reflect back and realize who Jesus really was, Jesus of Nazareth. It's, to me, it bears pointing out, because we see such a difference here. He's doing signs and wonders, but they're to the people of Egypt, it's to their detriment. It's not to their benefit. But it's doing the same thing. Both his signs and wonders of miracles and healings in the book of Acts was showing God's glory. His signs and wonders way back when he is doing things like turning their water into blood, is showing God's glory. Both things are pointing to God's glory. God is saying unequivocally, I will be glorified. I am the God of everything. That's what he's saying. He's saying it to them. He's saying that to Pharaoh. He's saying it to the people of Egypt. He's saying it to us. Pharaoh doesn't know it. I know the Nile is a river in Egypt, but Pharaoh was in denial. Sorry, I couldn't resist that one. It's like a dad joke and a pastor joke all wrapped into one. Okay. So if we look at verse 22, let's look at verse 22 real quick, because this is what this happens at first. So Pharaoh gets his magicians, verse 22. But the magicians of Egypt did the same with their secret arts, and Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he did not listen to them as the Lord had said. Sometimes I wonder if the magicians had discovered ancient Kool-Aid, you know, red Kool-Aid, and they were just like, check this out, Pharaoh. It turned red, it's blood. I don't know. We don't know what they really did. The thing that too, I always find comical about this is the first several plagues the magicians duplicate. And Pharaoh's like, ah, see, my magician can do it too. I'm not going to give in. But he doesn't get mad at them that they can't reverse it, right? They never reverse it. They don't put the water back to water. They just duplicate it. And just, I don't know, just to me, it's just interesting that I guess if I was Pharaoh, I'd be like, next thing, be like, okay, now make it go away. Otherwise, you know, I don't know, off with their head or something. Anyway, he doesn't. So then the frogs come. Chapter 8, starting in verse 1. Pharaoh doesn't relent. So then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite your whole territory with frogs. The Nile will swarm with frogs, which will come up and go into your house and into your bedroom and on your bed and into the houses of your servants and on your people and into your ovens and into your kneading bowls. There's going to be frogs everywhere. Not just a few frogs. So the frogs will come up on you and your people and all your servants. Then the Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand with your staff over the rivers, over the streams, and over the pools, and make frogs come up on the land of Egypt. So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters, and frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. Now here again, look, verse 7, the magicians, they did the same with their secret arts, making frogs come up on the land of Egypt. So again, if we were to continue reading, we see Pharaoh's heart is hardened again. He's like, look, my guys can do it too. I don't care. I'm not giving in. This pattern keeps going. There's a plague. At some point, the magicians are no longer able to reproduce the plague. We'll talk about that in a minute. The plague comes. He kind of starts to relent. He says, oh, okay. If you take it away, I'll be good. As soon as he takes it away, as soon as God removes it, as soon as the frogs actually die, they just die. It says later actually in this that they have to pile them in heaps, and the land of Egypt becomes foul because of the heaps of frog carcasses. As soon as that happens, Pharaoh's like, nope, not going to do it. Thanks for getting rid of the frogs. This guy is stubborn on a different level, by the way. This is all being done so that God can show his glory. You need to keep that in front of you. The signs and wonders are for the purpose of God showing his glory. Bit by bit, he is taking apart all these different false gods that they believe in, that they worship, over different parts of nature, over the Nile itself, which them is very life-giving, over the animals that are very life-giving. And God is taking that apart piece by piece, and he's saying, I alone will have the glory. The same thing happens again with the lice. Some of your translations say gnats. If you look at chapter 8, verse 16, we'll read about that. Then the Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your staff and strike the dust of the earth that it may become gnats through all the land of Egypt. They did so, and Aaron stretched out his hand with his staff and struck the dust of the earth, and there were gnats on man and beast. All the dust of the earth became gnats through all the land of Egypt. Now look at this, verse 18. The magicians tried with their secret arts to bring forth gnats, but they could not. So there were gnats on man and beast. But Pharaoh hardens his heart again anyway. Whether it was what we understand as gnats or whether it was lice, either way, it could not have been pleasant. It must have been miserable. And this guy still says, no, not giving in. So then the flies come. The flies follow the gnats. Chapter 8, verse 20. And then the cattle die. Chapter 9, verse 1. So we see that there continues to be a progression of what's happening. And he's continuing to touch different areas that as Egyptians, they say, this is what makes us who we are. This is what makes us mighty. This is what we rely on. This is what's important. This is what matters. These are our gods we worship. And God is just... he's wiping that clean. And still, Pharaoh's heart is hardened. And the same pattern keeps repeating it. Pharaoh says, okay, you guys got me. I'll give in. Please take this away. Please fix that. And so then it stops. And then as soon as it stops, Pharaoh's like, nope, not going to do it. Not going to give in. What's the point? You see all the same pattern. It keeps going. Let's look at chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and speak to him, thus says the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me. For if you refuse to let them go and continue to hold them, behold, the hand of the Lord will come with very severe pestilence on your livestock, which are in the field, on the horses, on the donkeys, on the camels, on the herds, and on the flocks. But the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt, so that nothing will die of all that belongs to the sons of Israel. The Lord set a definite time, saying, tomorrow the Lord will do this thing in the land. So the Lord did this thing on the next day, and all the livestock of Egypt died, but the livestock of the sons of Israel, not one died. Pharaoh said, and behold, there was not even one of the livestock of Israel dead, but the heart of Pharaoh was hardened, and he did not let the people go. God's signs and wonders. God shows his glory. Mankind hardens his heart. Does not relent. So here's the point. God is showing that no false gods, that no other power in heaven or on earth, anywhere in Egypt, no cattle, no thing, no stone idol, has power. Only he alone. And that he alone deserves to be worshiped. He's saying that same thing to us. He's saying that he wants to be the Lord of your whole life. He's saying through his word, through Moses and Aaron, there's a message to the people that were there then. But there's also a message to us now. There are lots of them. We talked about several of them. But I think the biggest point for us today, getting up to this fifth plague, is just that. It's that, do you want to be a Pharaoh? Really think about it. Now, of course, you're hopefully, in your private life, you're not enslaving an entire nation. Don't tell us if you are. Hopefully, your hardening heart things are maybe, as far as on a human scale, a little bit different. But in all seriousness, though, think about it. Pharaoh had places. It's almost as if he had like metaphorical kingdoms. He had kingdoms in his mind that would not crumble, that would not yield to God Almighty. What in your life, your job, your retirement, your house, a certain friend group, a certain activity, a place you go, the kinds of entertainment you consume, the movies you watch, the music you listen to. The list goes on. I can't fill the list for you. Only you can know, where are those areas where I've hardened my heart and said, I'm going to yield to you and everything else, God, but not this. This is for me. I'm keeping this back. Maybe you're not doing it on the scale that Pharaoh was doing it, but it's no less important. God is saying to you, I don't want to be just the Lord of some. I don't want you to yield to me in just part. I want your whole life. Think about when we talked about Job. Remember back to the book of Job. We were in Job, and we were looking at Job, and we saw that he lost everything. Everything he lost. And we see that in that, part of what was going on there was so that Job deep could cry out to deep in his sorrow, in the depth of his being stripped away, everything removed from him, everything taken away. Everything's being taken away from Pharaoh, but he refuses to cry out to the Lord. Don't be a Pharaoh. Surrender that. Whatever that is in your life, surrender it today. He alone has power over all creation. So as we draw to a close, we're going to have our guests, Susan and Gary, are going to come back up for a final song. And we're also going to have our worship team come back up, because we're going to roll from that. When they finish that special, we're going to roll into a closing song. And I want you to take some time This is a great time to reflect on what is it he's calling you to do. In preparation for this, I read the words of a theologian who talked about the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. He said that maybe one way to understand it is like a piece of clay. Right? A piece of clay versus a piece of wax. When they're exposed to heat, one hardens and one softens. So he's saying maybe that's one way. The heat, in a way, is the light. Think of the light of the sun, the light of God's truth beaming down into Pharaoh's heart. He decided to make his heart like clay. So the more that God's light shone down into his heart, the harder it became. Make your heart not like clay, but like wax. Be like the wax. As the light of God's truth shines into it, it softens. And as you walk this life with your Lord, you're more open, you're more ready, you're more softened to his teaching. Think on that as we enjoy this special and then as we enjoy the closing song.
Like the faint dawn of the morning, like the sweet freshness of dew, comes the dear whisper of Jesus, comforting tenderness and true. Darkness gives way to the sunlight, while his voice falls on my ear. Seasons of heaven refreshing, call to new gladness and cheer. Whispering hope, like the song of the making my heart in its sorrow rejoice, singing the song of forgiveness. Softly I hear in my soul, Jesus has conquered forever sin with his fearful control. Withering courage of warfare, blending thine ear when I pray. Glorious risen Redeemer, oh, how I praise thee today. And whispering hope, like the song of the angels, making in my heart. It is sorrow, rejoice. Hope is an anchor to keep us holding both steadfast and sure. Hope brings a wonderful cleansing through His blood, making us pure. Whispering hope of His coming, how my heart thrills at His word. And oh, to be watching and waiting, ready to welcome the Lord, and whispering hope like the song of the angels. Making my heart in His sorrow rejoice. Making my heart in His sorrow rejoice.